Reading this week is from Nehemiah chapter 2, verses 11 to 20. So I arrived in Jerusalem. 3 days later, I slipped out during the night, taking only a few others with me. I hadn't told anyone about the plans God had put in my heart for Jerusalem. We took no pack animals with us except the donkey I was riding. After dark, I went out through the valley gate, past the jackal's well, and over to the dung gate to inspect the broken walls and burnt gates. Then I went to the fountain gate and to the king's pool, but my donkey couldn't get through because of the rubble. So, though it was still dark, I went up the Kidron Valley instead, inspecting the walls before I turned back and entered again at the valley gate. And now Steve takes up the story from verse 16.
The city officials did not know I had been out there or what I was doing, for I had not yet said anything to anyone about my plans. I had not yet spoken to the Jewish leaders, the priests, the nobles, the officials, or anyone else in the administration. But now I said to them, "You know very well what trouble we are in. Jerusalem lies in ruins, and its gates have been destroyed by fire. Let's rebuild the wall of Jerusalem and end this disgrace." Then I told them about how gracious hand of God had been on me, about my conversation with the king. They replied at once, "Yes, let's build the wall." So they began the good work. But Sambalat and Tobiah and Geshem the Arab heard of our plans. They scoffed contemptuously. "What are you doing? Are you rebelling against the king?" they asked. I replied, "God of heaven, praise God, will help us succeed. We his servants will start rebuilding this wall and put, but you have no share, legal right, or historic claim in Jerusalem."
Thank you, Steve, for that reading from Nehemiah chapter 2. In this passage today, when we're looking at Nehemiah's preparation, it has three of the significant themes from the book of Nehemiah, and we're going to be looking at each of them today. And just so as you can remember them, they all start with the letter O. We're looking at the opposition to Nehemiah. Then secondly, we'll be looking at the obedience of Nehemiah. And then thirdly, sorry, there's a big word in here, the omniscience of the God that Nehemiah trusts. So let's look at those one at a time. And let's look and let's try and apply them to ourselves as we go through this. Okay? First of all, the opposition. You know, two of the three characters that Steve was worried about getting right in verse 19 have already appeared in verse 10 at the end of the reading for last week. And verse 10 says this, "When Sanballat the Horonite and Tobiah the Ammonite official heard of my arrival," Nehemiah says, "they were very displeased that someone had come to help the people of Israel." So, and after those two appearances in chapter 2, they keep cropping up later on. This is the opposition to Nehemiah. And I wonder whether you and I in our daily tasks sometimes feel that there's opposition and it's difficult to deal with. Well, let's see how Nehemiah dealt with this. First of all, who were these guys? Well, The Horonites and the Ammonites were two of the people groups that God displaced, had driven out from the promised land when the Israelites came. And Sanballat, Tobiah, and Geshem, the three of them, were, we believe, regional governors serving the king of Persia, that king Artaxerxes that we read and heard about last week. And they were part of that movement of for generations after Israel had first possessed the promised land. Some of the enemies wanted it back, and they were very happy to see Jerusalem in ruins. Now, if we come to verses 19 and 20 of our reading, we see that Sanballat and Tobiah opposed Nehemiah in three ways in those verses. First of all, they laughed at Nehemiah and the people. Then, secondly, they despised them. They greeted them with scorn and with contempt. And thirdly, they accused them of rebelling against the king. Now, how ridiculous is that? Because Nehemiah had a relationship with the king, and yet here they are trying to stir up insurrection, saying, "You're rebelling, you're rebelling." And sometimes when we face opposition, we've got to step back from it a bit, and we've got to look and see what is real here and what is something that people are making innuendos about. I wonder what you have faced maybe in this last week or two that seems to you to be opposition, and whether you can face that as Nehemiah did. Because secondly, the second point was we look at the obedience of Nehemiah. The obedience of Nehemiah, which comes through all of this book, but particularly here in this chapter. It starts with when I arrived in Jerusalem in verse 11. And this arrival in Jerusalem that we have been looking forward to for the last 3 or 4 weeks wasn't something that was just an impetuous reaction from Nehemiah. Remember, Gordon talked about the passion that he had as he was thinking and as he heard the news that was brought to him by Hanani. Jonathan then took us into his prayer in chapter 1. What a tremendous prayer that is. And how, as Jonathan reminded us, it focuses on the same things that the Lord's Prayer that we know and are more familiar with focuses on. And then last week, Simon talked about the partnership, not only the partnership with the king, with Artaxerxes, but the partnership with Hanani, his brother, and how that had gone on. I wonder what sort of preparation you are making for the future. It's something that we as a church are having to address. We're going to have leadership meetings that will look at how do we cope as this lockdown continues. And you see, for Nehemiah, he was able to do that in a way that honoured God, because of he knew that the plan that he was executing was God's plan. It wasn't his plan. He recognised that God had put this in his heart. We've got that in the reading. So as Nehemiah waited on God's time and sought the Lord for wisdom, he was planning accordingly. And now that he had got to Jerusalem, now was the time for him to assess the task for himself before sharing this challenge with the people to trust their God. And so he got on his donkey at dead of night and he reconnoitred. He looked at the task that lay before him. He researched it. He decided that he needed to acquaint himself with what was happening. And he did that. He went through these various gates, out the valley gate, past the Jacob's well, past the dung gate. And he did this with a very few people, and he hadn't shared what was on his heart at this stage. But he prepared and did that well, all in obedience to God, the God that he adored. That brings us to our third point, which is the omniscience of God, the fact that God was all-knowing, all-powerful, and that he was able to know everything about Nehemiah. Do you see it in this passage? There are three key verses here that lift this up for us. We see that Nehemiah said, and I've already referred to this, that the plans God had put in his heart for Jerusalem. He wasn't just devising his own plan, but he was looking and thinking about God's plans for it. And then verse 18, when he shared with the people, when he shared with the officials and the administration, he was able to say, "The gracious hand of God has been on me." And then in verse 20, he said, with absolute assurance, the absolute confidence in God, he said, "The God of heaven will help us succeed." What does this word in omniscience mean? Let me give you two other illustrations of that. In Matthew's Gospel, Matthew 10, Matthew tells us that even the hairs of our head are numbered. No matter how carefully we keep the secrets from others, we have no secrets from God. You see, God knows all about us. And sometimes we try to hide things from other people, but sometimes we cannot hide things from God. And then the psalmist David said in Psalm 139, he said, "You have searched me, Lord. You know me. You know when I sit, when I rise. You perceive my thoughts from afar. You discern my going out, my lying down. You're familiar with all your ways." And then listen to this. "Before a word is on my tongue, you, Lord, know it completely." I wonder, have you experienced this? The sense that God knows all about you. He knows the mistakes you've made, but he loves you nevertheless. He knows where you've come from, and he wants to comfort and uphold you. I was just reading recently, we've heard already about Tony Horsfall facing the coronavirus epidemic with his wife in this nursing home, and we prayed for him and we continue to do that. But Tony said something, that he read a book that said, "God respects more when we say we trust him than when we say we love him." And I wonder today if you can trust God for what is in your life. Someone has said that fear is false evidence appearing real. Got it? F-E-A-R. False evidence appearing real. And, you know, Nehemiah was confronted with a hopeless situation. He could have just recoiled in fear. But by waiting on God and hearing of God's plans for Jerusalem, he was able to inspire others. Remember the accusation that was made against him by the opposition, that he was rebelling against the king. Look in verse 19. But he had already told the people in verse 18 of his conversation with the king. He didn't just have conversation with the king. He had letters from the king. What trust, what confidence, what hope that engendered in him and through him to the people of Jerusalem. I was listening to the radio this morning, and there was a man who was the winner of the 2020 Templeton Prize. And he said this. He's looking and investigating. He's a scientist. And he was looking for the solution to this virus. But he said something that really struck me. He said, "One thing that is more infectious than the virus is hope." Where is our hope? Who do we base our hope in? In a few moments, after I hand over to Jonathan, we're going to finish our service by singing Cornerstone. And this has got the words, and Elise is going to help us with this. It's got these words, "My hope is built on nothing less than Jesus' blood and righteousness. I dare not trust the sweetest frame, but wholly trust in Jesus' name." Nehemiah had that confidence. He had that trust. Yes, he faced opposition, but he was obedient to what God was telling him to do. And he trusted in the omniscient God who was in control of him and is in control of us and in control of the virus and in control of the governments of the world today. Let's trust him this coming week. Amen.